Chapter 13, Motion and Time. In class 6, you learned about different types of motions. You learned that a motion could be along a straight line, it could be circular or periodic. Can you recall these three types of motions? Table 13.1 gives some common examples of motions. Identify the type of motion in each case. It is common experience that the motion of some objects is slow while that of some other is fast. Slow or fast? We know that some vehicles move faster than others. Even the same vehicle may move faster or slower at different times. Make a list of 10 objects moving along a straight path. Group the motion of these objects as slow and fast. How did you decide which object is moving slow and which one is moving fast? If vehicles are moving on a road in the same direction, we can easily tell which one of them is moving faster than the other. Let us look at the motion of vehicles moving on a road. Activity 13.1. Look at figure 13.1. It shows the position of some vehicles moving on a road in the same direction at this same in some instant of time. Now look at figure 13.2. It shows the position of same vehicle after some time. From your observation of the two figures, answer the following questions. Which vehicle is moving the fastest of all? Which one of them is moving the slowest of all? The distance moved by objects in a given interval of time can help us to decide which one is the faster or slower. For example, imagine that you have gone to see off your friend at the bus stand. Suppose you start pedaling your bicycle at the same time as the bus begins to move, the distance covered by you after 5 minutes would be much smaller than that covered by this bus. Would you say that the bus is moving faster than bicycle? We often say that the faster vehicle has a higher speed. In a 100 meter race, it is easy to decide whose speed is the highest. One who takes shortest time to cover the distance of 100 meters has the highest speed. 13.2 speed. You are probably familiar with the word speed. In the examples given above, a higher speed seems to indicate that a given distance has been covered in a shorter time or a larger distance covered in a given time. The most convenient way to find out which of the two or more objects is moving faster is to compare the distance moved by them in a unit time. Thus, if you know the distance covered by two buses in 1 hour, we can tell which one is faster. We call the distance covered by an object in a unit time as the speed of the object. When we say that a car is moving with a speed of 50 km per hour, it implies that it will cover a distance of 50 km in 1 hour. However, a car seldom moves with a constant speed for 1 hour. In fact, it starts moving slowly and then picks up speed. So, when we say that the car has a speed of 50 km per hour, we usually consider only the total distance covered by it in 1 hour. We do not bother whether the car has been moving with a constant speed or not during that hour. The speed calculated here is actually the average speed of the car. In this book, we shall use the term speed for average speed. So, for us, the speed is the total distance covered divided by the total time taken. Thus, speed is equal to total distance covered divided by total time taken. In everyday life, we seldom find objects moving with a constant speed over long distances or for long duration of time. If the speed of an object moving along a straight line keeps changing, its motion is said to be non-uniform. On the other hand, an object moving along a straight line with a constant speed is said to be in uniform motion. In this case, the average speed is the same as the actual speed. We can determine the speed of a given object once we can measure the time taken by it to cover a certain distance. In class 6, you learned how to measure distances. But how do we measure time? Let us find out. Measurement of time. If you did not have a clock, how would you decide what time was the day it is? Have you ever wondered how our elders could tell the approximate time of the day by just looking at the shadows? How do we measure time interval of a month, a year? Our ancestors noticed that many events in nature repeat themselves after a definite interval of time. For example, they found the sun rises every day in the morning. The time between one sunrise and the next was called a day. Similarly, a month was measured from one new moon to the next. A year was fixed as the time taken by the earth to complete one revolution of the sun. Often we need to measure intervals of time which are much shorter than a day. Clocks or watches are perhaps the most common time measuring devices. Have you ever wondered how clocks and watches measure time? The working of clock is rather complex, but all of them make use of some periodic motion. One of the most well-known periodic motion is that of a simple pendulum. A simple pendulum consists of a small metallic ball or a piece of a stone suspended from a rigid stand by a thread. The metallic ball is called the bob of the pendulum. Figure 13.8 shows the pendulum at rest in its mean position. When the bob of the pendulum is released after taking a slightly to one side, it begins to move to and fro. The to and fro motion of a simple pendulum is an example of a periodic or an oscillatory motion. The pendulum is said to have completed one oscillation when its bob, starting from its mean position O, moves to A to B and back to O. The pendulum also completes one oscillation when its bob moves from one extreme position to A to the other extreme position B and comes back to A. The time taken by the pendulum to complete one oscillation is called time period. Activity 13.2. Set up a simple pendulum as shown in a figure 13.8 with a thread or a string of a length nearly 1 meter. Switch off any fans nearby. Let the bob of the pendulum comes to rest at its mean position. Mark the mean position of the bob on the floor below it or on the wall behind it. To measure the time period of the pendulum, we will need a stopwatch. However, if a stopwatch is not available, a table clock or a wristwatch can be used. To set the pendulum in motion, gently hold the bob and move it slightly to one side. Make sure that the string attached to the bob is taut while displace it. Now release the bob from its displaced position. Remember that the bob is not to be pushed when it is released. Note the time on the clock when the bob is at its mean position. Instead of the mean position, you may note the time when the bob is at one of its extreme positions. Measure the time the pendulum takes to complete 20 oscillations. Record your observations. In table 13.2, the first observation shown is a just sample. Your observation could be different from this. Repeat this activity a few times and record your observations. By dividing the time taken for 20 oscillations by 20, get the time taken for one zone oscillation or the time period of the pendulum. Is the time period of your pendulum nearly the same in all classes? All cases, note that a slight change in the initial displacement does not affect the time period of your pendulum. Nowadays, most clocks or watches have an electric circuit with one or more cells. These clocks are called quartz clocks. The time measured by quartz clock is much more accurate than by the clocks available earlier. Units of time and speed. The basic unit of time is a second. Its symbol is S. Large units of time are minutes and hours. You already know how these units are related to one another. What would be the basic unit of speed? Since speed is a distance or a time, the basic unit of speed is meter per second. Of course, it could also be expressed in other units such as meter per minute or kilometer per hour. You must remember that the symbols of units are written in a singular. For example, we write 50 km and not as 50 kilometers, or k 8 cm, not as 8 centimeters. Guju is wondering how many seconds there are in a day and how many hours in a year. Can you help him? Different units of time are used depending on the need. For example, it is convenient to express your age in years rather than in a days or hours. Similarly, it will not be wise to express in years the time taken by you to cover the distance between your home and your school. How small or large is the time interval of 1 second? The time taken in saying aloud 2001 is nearby 1 second. Verify it by counting aloud from 2001 to 2010. The pulse of a normal healthy adult at rest beat about 22 times in a minute. That is about 12 times in
10 seconds. This rate may be slightly higher for children. Many time measuring devices were used in different parts of the world before the pendulum clocks became popular. Sundials, voodoo clocks, and sand clocks are some examples of such devices. Different designs of these devices were developed in different parts of the world. Measuring speed. Having learned how to measure time and distance, you can calculate the speed of an object. Let us find out the speed of ball moving along the ground. Activity 13.3. Draw a straight line on the ground with a chalk border or a line and ask one of your friends to stand 1 to 2 meters away from it. Let your friend gently roll a ball along the ground in a direction perpendicular to the line. Note the time at the moment the ball crosses the line and also when it comes to rest. How much time does the ball take to come to or rest? Measure the distance between the point at which the ball crosses the line and the point where it comes to rest. You can use a scale or a measuring tape. Let different groups repeat the activity. Record the measurements in table 13.3. In each case, calculate the speed of the ball. You may now like to compare your speed of walking or cycling with that of your friends. You need to know the distance of the school from your home or from the other point. Each one of you can then measure the time taken to cover that distance and calculate your speed. It may be interesting to know who amongst you is the fastest. Speeds of some living organisms are given in a table 13.4 in kilometer per hour. You can calculate the speeds in meter per second yourself. Rockets launching satellites into Earth orbit often attain speeds up to the 8 km per second. On the other hand, a tortoise can move only with a speed of about 8 cm per second. Can you calculate how fast is the rocket compared with the tortoise? Once you know the speed of an object, you can find the distance moved by it in a given time. All you have to do is simply to multiply the speed by time. Thus, distance covered is equal to speed into time. You can also find the time an object would take to cover a distance while moving with a given speed. Time taken is equal to distance by speed. You might have seen a meter fitted on top of a scooter or a motorcycle. Similarly, meters can be seen on the dashboards of cars, buses and other vehicles. Figure 13.7 shows the dashboard of a car. Note that one of the meters has kilometer per hour written at one corner. This is called as a speedometer. It records the speed directly in kilometer per hour. There is also another meter that measures the distance moved by the vehicle. This meter is known as odometer. While going for a school picnic, Paheli decided to note the reading on the odometer of the bus after every 30 minutes till the end of the journey. Later on, she recorded her readings in a table 13.5. Can you tell how far was the picnic spot from the school? Can you calculate the speed of the bus? Looking at the table, Pujo asked Paheli whether she can tell how far they would have traveled till 9:45 a.m. Paheli had no answer to this question. They went to their children. She told them that one way to solve this problem is to plot a distance time graph. Let us find out how such a graph is plotted. Distance time graph. You might have seen that newspapers, magazines, etc. present information in various forms of graphs to make it interesting. The type of graph shown in a figure 13.8 is known as a bar graph. Another type of a graphical representation is a pie chart. 13.9. The graph shown in figure 13.10 is an example of a line graph. The distance time graph is a line graph. Let us learn to make such a graph. Take a sheet of a graph paper. Draw two lines perpendicular to each other on it, as shown in figure 13.11. Mark the horizontal line as XOX dash. It is known as the X-axis. Similarly, mark the vertical line YOY dash. It is called as a Y-axis. The point of intersection of XOX dash and YOY dash is known as the origin O. The two quantities between which the graph is drawn are shown along these two axes. We show the positive values on the x-axis along OX. Similarly, positive values on the y-axis are shown along OY. In this chapter, we shall consider only the positive values of quantities. Therefore, we shall use only the shaded part of the graph shown in the figure 13.11. Bujo and Paheli found out the distance traveled by a car and the time taken by it to cover that distance. Their data is shown in the table 13.6. You can make the graph by following the steps given below. Draw two perpendicular lines to represent the two axes and mark them as OX and OY as shown in the figure 13.11. Decide the quantity to be shown along the x-axis and that to be shown along the y-axis. In this case, we show the time along the x-axis and the distance along the y-axis. Choose a scale to represent the distance and another to represent the time on the graph. For the motion of the car, scales could be time 1 minute is equal to 1 centimeter, distance is 1 kilometer is equal to 1 centimeter. Mark values for the time and the distance on the respective axis according to the scale you have chosen. For the motion of the car, mark the time 1 minute or 2 minute and so on. The x-axis from the origin, similarly mark the distance 1 kilometer, 2 kilometer and so on the y-axis. Now you have to mark
the points on the graph paper to represent each set of values for distance and time. Observation recorded at S number 1 in table 13.6 shows that at time 0 minute, the distance moved is also 0. The point corresponding to this set of values on the graph will therefore be the origin itself. After 1 minute, the car has moved distance of 1 kilometer. To mark this set of values, look for the point that represents 1 minute on the x-axis. Draw a line parallel to the y-axis at this point, then draw a line parallel to the x-axis from the point corresponding to the distance 1 kilometer on the y-axis. The point where these two lines intersect represent this set of values on the graph, figure 13.12. Similarly, mark on the graph paper the points corresponding to different sets of values. Figure 13.12 shows the set of points on the graph corresponding to positions of the car at various times. Join all the points on the graph as shown in the figure 13.13. It is a straight line. This is the distance time graph for the motion of the car. If the distance time graph is a straight line, it indicates that the object is moving with a constant speed. However, if the speed of the object keeps changing, the graph can be of any other shape. Generally, the choice of scales is not as simple as in the example given in figure 13.12 and 13.13. We may have to choose two different scales to represent the desired quantities on the x-axis and y-axis. Let us try to understand this process with an example. Let us again consider the motion of the bus that took Paheli and her friends to the picnic. The distance covered and the distance covered and time taken by the bus are shown in the table 13.5. The total distance covered by the bus is 80 km. If we decide to choose a scale 1 km is equal to 1 cm, we shall have to draw an axis of length 80 cm. This is not possible on a short sheet of paper. On the other hand, a scale 10 km is equal to 1 cm would require an axis of a length only 8 cm. This scale is quite convenient. However, the graph may cover only a small part of the graph paper. Some of the points are to be kept in mind while choosing the most suitable scale for drawing a graph are the difference between the highest and the lowest values of each quantity, the intermediate values of each quantity so that with the scale chosen, it is convenient to mark the values on the graph and to utilize the maximum part of the paper on which the graph is to be drawn. Suppose that you are given a graph paper of size 25 cm into 25 cm, one of the scales which meets the above conditions and can accommodate the data of table 13.5 could be distance is equal to 5 km is equal to 1 cm and time 6 minutes is equal to 1 cm. Can you now draw the distance time graph for the motion of the bus? Is the graph drawn by you similar to that shown in a figure 13.13? The distance time graph provides a variety of information about the motion when compared to the data presented by a table. For example, Table 13.5 gives information about the distance moved by the bus only at some definite time intervals. On the other hand, from the distance time graph, we can find the distance moved by the bus at any distance of time. Suppose we want to know how much distance the bus had traveled at 8:15 a.m., we mark the point corresponding to the time on the x-axis. Suppose this point is A, next we draw a line perpendicular to the x-axis or parallel to the y-axis at a point A. We then mark the point T on the graph at which the perpendicular line intersects it. Figure 13.14. Next, we draw a line through the point T parallel to the x-axis. This intersects the y-axis at the point B. The distance corresponding to the point B on the y-axis OB gives us the distance in kilometer covered by the bus at 8:15 a.m. How much is this distance in kilometer? Can you now help Paheli to find the distance moved by the bus at 9:45 a.m.? Can you also find the speed of the bus from its distance time graph? Thank you.